Good evening, everybody. It's Lawrence Leiser again, introducing to you our second First Monday of the 2021 season. We had a terrific time the beginning of October for a very joyful concert with music of Beethoven and Mozart. And I hope you liked it, and I hope you're back for this one. This one we gave a lot of thought to because, you know, tomorrow is the election. And of course, we're all anxious about that and trying to figure out what's going to happen. Things are kind of unsettled. And at one point I thought, well, maybe we just won't do one. But the more I thought about it, the more I decided it was the time to say something not political, but emotional about our country. And so this concert tonight celebrates America. America is a place of great ideals and a huge wealth of talent from people from many, many different places. And so tonight's program is going to celebrate that. Not all the pieces are written by Americans, but all of them were written in America. First tonight, we're going to go to one of the great, great creators of the 20th century, Duke Ellington. He was born in Washington, D.C. in 1899, and keep that date in your mind because a little later we're going to do, at the end of the program, a great piece by Aaron Copland. He was born 1 year later, 1900. So they're quite different from one another, and both supreme artists. Ellington got his start in Washington, D.C., where he was born, began to play in clubs in his 20s, and rose very quickly. And he was very popular immediately because the music he was doing, which was jazz, was swing, and he had huge audiences for that, whether they were in clubs or however they did it, or recordings he did a lot of. Somewhere along the line, by around 1940, he began to feel like he wanted to branch out in other directions. And he began to be interested in the history in this country of Black Americans. And he wrote a big piece called Black, Brown, and Beige, which was premiered in January of 1943 in Carnegie Hall. And in that, he was talking about many, many different experiences of Black people in this country. And in that first part, he focused on the religion of his people. And that led him to write a piece that is iconic now. It's extremely well known, called Come Sunday, which ends with the words, "Up from dawn till sunset, man work hard all the day. Come Sunday, oh, come Sunday, that's the day." And that's the church day. We're going to present it tonight. I want to tell you just a little bit about it. It was part of that big event in Carnegie Hall. And by the way, that whole production came here to Boston about 2 weeks later. So he hooked up with the greatest gospel singer of his time, Mahalia Jackson. And they recorded it. And I've heard that recording, and it's kind of magical. With Duke Ellington playing the piano, Mahalia Jackson singing Come Sunday, and an obbligato violin. It's powerful music. It's meaningful music. It's a strong message about faith. And the performance we're going to hear tonight is done by a talented young woman who is a student here, Naledi Masilo, with our stalwart Hankus Netsky and Eden McAdam Summer. So without further ado, let's go ahead and join them while they play and sing that piece.
Lord, dear Lord above, God Almighty, God and see my people through.
Thank you.
to him in secret, he will hear your every breath. Up from dawn till sunset, men work hard all day, but come Sunday, that's the good. That's the good day.
So the next piece on our program tonight was written in this country, but not by an American. It was none other than Antonín Dvořák. Dvořák came to New York around 1891 because a wealthy woman in that city, New York, wanted him to lead what was known as the National Conservatory of Music. And he got a very large salary for doing it, and he came with his wife and six children, and they settled into New York. Sometime that year, he learned that there was a colony of Czech people living in a small town in Iowa called Spillville. And one of his friends in New York said, you know, we should go out there. My family is there, and I think you would love being there. So they went out, all of them. It took a long time to get there, you know, by train and whatever. And when they finally arrived, it was June of that year, of 1893. And he fell head over heels in love with the place. First of all, he was surrounded by people with whom he could speak in his native tongue. But he loved the openness of the countryside. And almost immediately after arriving, he wrote a string quartet, his opus 96, called The American String Quartet. Very famous piece. Many people play it. You may have heard it. And as soon as he got done with that, he said, I'm not done on this topic. I'm going to write a piece for string quartet and extra viola. Now, what you may not know is that as a young man, although Dvořák played piano, he was originally a string player. And he had a job playing in the opera as a young fellow, getting a job, getting work, you know, playing viola in the national opera of his country in Prague. So he had an interest in viola. So he wrote this piece, and I think he finished it within 2 or 3 weeks. It's kind of amazing. And he wrote that piece, and then in the slow movement, which is so beautiful, the second half of the theme, he remembered that he had written a sketch for a national anthem for the United States, and he used what he had sketched then in there. So the piece is also called The American. One is The American Quartet and one is The American Quintet. And within a year after that, he wrote his great From the New World Symphony, which is more of the same stuff. He was absolutely captivated by the music he heard from the people there, and of course, very happy to be with his friends. Anyway, without further ado, let's listen to this fantastic piece. It's broad-scaled, it's tuneful. I won't say everything is American about it. There's an awful lot of his country in it, too. But it's of the people. So here we go.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you.
The next piece we're going to hear tonight is a world premiere. I'm very excited about that. We have on our faculty here one of the great jazz pianists anywhere. His name is Jason Moran. He's been on our faculty at NEC for 10 years. He's ahead of the jazz program at the Kennedy Center. He's from Houston, Texas. And he is just so good. Anyway, we talked about this for a while, and it took him a long time to figure out what he could and would do. And he finally said, I'm going to send you a piece. It's only about 5 minutes long. It's just me playing, but it's what I want to say. So what did he give us? The piece is called Follow the Light. He said it's not so much a piece as it is a feeling, a piece to combat the dark seasons we are experiencing. When he sent it in, he sent me some more words, and he said I could read those to you, and I will read it. There is a scent in the sound, crisp and greasy. And for now, it carries the day. Some ask to stop and listen. Others ask to stop listening. I know light when it attacks. I believe when I follow. Jason Moran. Here's his piece. You know, it's been very difficult because of the pandemic to get people together from wherever to rehearse with all kinds of constraints on how much time we can spend together, how much time we can get in the hall, how much time the hall has to be empty so that the air cleans out. And so we were talking about it, and the idea came up, maybe you could look back on things that you did earlier on First Monday and find something to celebrate the series. And then it hit me. Yes, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. 2 years ago, I think it was October 1st, 2018, we had an All-American program also. And the program had in it almost the most famous piece by a serious composer, an American classical composer, Aaron Copland. The piece is called Appalachian Spring, and I'll bet most of you have heard it at some point or another. I grew up with it. And I'll give you just a little bit about how that piece came to be written. He was commissioned by the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C., under the support of Elizabeth Sprague Coolidge, who was the cousin of President Coolidge from Massachusetts, I think, to write a piece for the dancer Martha Graham. And he wrote this piece with no title except for Ballet for Martha. The first performance of it was done on October 30th, 1944, at the Library of Congress. I'm not quite sure how they fit everything together, because that's a small hall that I played in. It was one of the great places in this country to be able to perform. There were 13 players. And Martha Graham danced. There were four dancers. And it had its beginnings then. Interestingly, also, the set was designed by an American-Japanese artist. You may know his name, Isamu Noguchi. Noguchi was a sculptor, mostly, whose father was Japanese, but who lived mostly in Long Island. And there is a museum dedicated to him now, one of the great American artists of the 20th century. Anyway, the whole idea was that he was supposed to write a piece on an American theme. And in fact, the piece the following year won the Pulitzer Prize, 1945. And what was the piece about? It was about a young couple about to get married with dreams of what should come and the building of a house for them and a serious commentary by an old settler woman about that they would have high moments and low moments, but that would be good. There was no title to the piece yet. And then Martha Graham said, you know, I was reading poems by the American poet Hart Crane from the time of the Civil War. And he wrote a piece in which the first words were Appalachian Spring. Now, everybody thinks this name was given to it after the piece was written. Everybody thinks that it has to do with springtime in Appalachia, and that's kind of what it led to. But actually, Hart Crane was talking about a spring where water comes out. But anyway, we all think of it as the springtime piece. And the great glory of this piece is toward the end, there is a shaker tune called The Gift to Be Simple, and you've all heard it. You know, you'll hear it full glory. And this piece, we're doing it in the version that it was first written for as ballet for 13 players. Later, Copland made it for full symphony orchestra, and the version we're hearing has 10 minutes of the ballet music taken out that he said were not so interesting just as music, they were needed for the choreography. I'll have a few final words to say when we finish that. But let's listen to it. It's a great performance. It's a great piece. and I should say thanks to Nicholas Kitchen, who likes to make videos of any time he performs, and he's the first violinist in it. And because of that, because we've almost never made videos until this year of First Monday concerts, we had a video of it. So you get to see it and hear it. You know, people my age are forgetful. I just turned 82 last week. One more thing I wanted to share with you. That's me with Aaron Copland at a rehearsal in Los Angeles of his Vitebsk Piano Trio. It's from about 1967, and the series there was called Monday Evening Concerts. Sounds sort of familiar, don't you think? Anyway, now to the performance.
Thank you. Thank you.
So that's our program tonight, folks. A program of American music, celebrating who we are. Tomorrow's a big day for us. It's election day. Everybody has different ideas of what they think is right for this country. But the most important thing is that we express them. So my last words for you tonight are, be sure to vote tomorrow. Thanks.